Hello children, welcome to the class. We are with the chapter Diversity in Living Organisms, isn't it? So in our previous videos, we have discussed everything about the kingdom Plantae and the subdivisions of the kingdom Plantae. So each and every division's characteristics, examples, everything we studied. And now we are going to the kingdom Animalia. And this Animalia kingdom is very, very big kingdom here. And this Animalia kingdom is again divided into certain categories. And we call those categories as phyla. Phyla is plural. Phylum is singular. Okay. So many phyla will come under a kingdom Animalia. Right? See, in the starting introductory class, we discussed about hierarchy of classification, right? So all living organisms were classified into how many kingdoms, guys? 5 kingdoms, isn't it? And each and every kingdom is classified into division or phyla. Okay, phyla is plural, phylum is singular. See, the kingdom Plantae is divided into divisions. The kingdom Animalia is divided. Animalia's subdivisions are called phyla. Plantae's subdivisions are called division, guys. Okay, and now each and every division of Plantae, each and every division of phyla is again classified into different classes. Okay. So each phyla, Animalia is divided into so many phyla. So many phylums will come, guys. Okay. And each phyla is again divided into classes. And each class is divided into order. Each order is divided into family. And each family is divided into genus. And each genus is divided into species. All this we know. Okay. We are studying only this level. Okay. So we know how the 5 kingdoms are classified. Discussed each and every kingdom's characteristics. Later, the kingdom Plantae's divisions we studied. And now Animalia is further divided into so many phyla, isn't it? So all the phylums I am going to mention in this class, and each and every phylum's characteristics we have to study in a chapter, guys. Clear? So let us quickly go for looking at what different phyla can come under a kingdom Animalia. Clear? And remember, guys, before I divide kingdom Animalia into different phyla, let us try to recall the characteristics of kingdom Animalia. I'll just try to revise the characteristics. First thing you should keep it in your mind is all organisms that is coming under Animalia are multicellular. Okay, the body is made up of so many cells. And the cells are eukaryotic. What do you mean by eukaryotic? Each and every cell organelle and nucleus has a very, very distinct membrane, right? And you know, they are autotrophic. What do you mean by autotrophic? These organisms which are coming under Animalia cannot synthesize their own food. They have to depend on other organisms or other living things for their survival, right? Fine. So these are the 3 main points you have to keep it in mind. All Animalia, all organisms under Animalia are multicellular and they are eukaryotic. They are heterotrophic. And they do not have cell walls. The cells of the organisms do not have cell wall. Right? Fine. And now, before I divide Animalia into phyla, I would like to classify all organisms under Animalia initially into two categories. Okay, and the first category is vertebrata. Vertebrata, and the other category is invertebrata. This is very important. Try to understand. Okay, so before I divide Animalia into various phyla, what I did? I categorized, I separated all organisms coming under kingdom Animalia into two categories. One is vertebrata, other one is invertebrata. So what do you mean by vertebrata? Vertebrata in the sense, the organisms which are coming under vertebrata have a backbone, guys. In simple language, I can say the organisms which have backbone, human beings, definitely we have a backbone, right? And many animals, you see the backbone, right? So the organisms which have a backbone are placed under vertebrata. So what I can write here, organisms with backbone are called vertebrates, and organisms without backbone are coming under, you know, invertebrata. They are called as invertebrates. Clear? And now let us try to discuss what phylums comes under invertebrata as well as vertebrata. I told you Animalia is divided into many categories, guys. What are those categories called? Phyla. Okay, some phyla will come under vertebrate and some phyla are placed under invertebrata. Okay, so let us try to list out what phyla can come under invertebrate. Like, the organisms which do not have backbone, you know, they are classified into various phyla, guys. I'm going to mention the phylum's name. The first and foremost, here comes the phylum Porifera. Porifera, very primitive type of organisms. Okay, so most of the organisms under Porifera are marine. Not most of them, all of the organisms coming under Porifera are marine. They live in ocean. Very simple organisms. Okay, and the second phylum is phylum Coelenterata. Coelenterata. Okay, so you have to remember all these names. It's very important. So the third one is Platyhelminthes. Platyhelminthes. Next one, the phylum Nematoda. Phylum Nematoda. Phylum Annelida. Annelida. Next is the phylum Arthropoda. Arthropoda. Next, phylum Mollusca. Mollusca. Next, the phylum Echinodermata. Echinodermata. All these names are quite weird, isn't it? Quite difficult to remember, but still you have to remember, guys. So these are the various phyla that is coming under Animalia kingdom. Yeah. And the last and final phylum that you observe under invertebrata category is Protocordata. Phylum Protocordata. Clear? So these are the phylum, different phyla that come under invertebrata category of Animalia. Okay, so what do you mean by invertebrates? Organisms without backbone. So whichever organisms that come under these phyla, all of them do not have a backbone, right? And now let us try to discuss the various phyla that come under vertebrata. The first one is phylum Pisces. species, all kinds of fishes, you know, come under this particular phylum. Next one, phylum Amphibia. Amphibia. Next, the phylum Reptilia. Reptilia. Phylum Aves. Phylum Mammalia. So all human beings and, you know, all different organisms like all cats, dogs, tigers, elephants. So these animals and human beings, you know, can be placed under Mammalia, right? So now we have to discuss each and every phylum's characteristics. Okay, how is their body made up of, what are their features, what are their general characters, what examples we can see, where these organisms are present, all of them we are going to discuss phylum by phylum. Okay, first let us try to discuss about the phyla that are present in invertebrata category. Clear? First we will go with the phylum Porifera, right? See everyone, coming to the phylum Porifera, it's a very primitive type of a phylum. The organisms under Porifera is very simple, guys. They do not have complicated body structure. Very simple body structure you can observe in this phylum Porifera. And the organisms are commonly called with the name sponges. Okay, so what I would like to write here is, the organisms which come under this phylum Porifera are called as sponges. Okay, this is very, very important because, you know, they are sponge-like. They are just sponge-like. Say, why they are sponge-like, you will understand later. I'll tell the points. Yeah, so these organisms are also called as sponges. Clear? Fine. And the next point I would like to write here is, you know, the word itself says Porifera. You know what? The entire body has pores here. What do you mean by pores? Small holes are called pores. Clear? So the body is with pores. What do you mean by pores? Small holes. Okay. So entire body is perforated. That is, it has holes all around the body. Say for example, you know, this is how the poriferans look like. Here. See, if this is a Porifera organism, just see, there are no body parts here. There are no hands, there are no legs. Like animals, they do not have anything. They are very old type of organisms. Okay. So, all over the body, you will find small holes, guys. So, this is the main nature of Porifera. Clear? And these organisms do not move. They do not move and they are attached to a particular surface. They are always attached. They are attached to a surface. They don't move. Clear? So this is the basic characteristics of the organisms that come under Porifera. And now, actually speaking, these pores, you know, inwardly, they will open up into a large cavity, guys. Okay. Say, if I see internal structure, say, for example, this is outward structure. Outward structure has pores. If I see inward, okay, if I cut this and see, you know, you will find these pores are open up into a large cavity. You will find a large cavity, large space inside an organism. And that cavity is called spongocoel. That cavity is called spongocoel. So what I would like to write here is, pores gets opened into a large cavity called spongocoel. This is very, very important point. Spongocele. So inside a body, you do not have any organs. You do not have heart. You don't have liver or no such organs. There is one cavity. Okay. All pores will open. They will join to a big cavity. What is that cavity called as? Spongocele. Clear? And pores. These pores with spongocele. Spongocele makes water canal system. This is a very important point here. This makes water canal system. Okay. So, pores will get opened up into a large cavity. Pores together with spongocele cavity is called water canal system. So, through these pores, you know, water, food, whatever oxygen, you know, gases that is necessary for the organisms will go through these pores into the cavity, guys. So, pores with spongocele is called as water canal system. So, what is the use of this water canal system? Helps in transporting. Helps in transporting water, food. Okay, food to the entire body of an organism. Body of an organism. Okay. See, through the pores, actually water enters inside and it reaches to the cavity. And through the cavity, the water, food, everything goes to the entire organism. And whatever waste is there, this is a living thing. It also has certain waste, isn't it? So that waste will come out. You know, here you have a small opening, guys, actually. So this is outer body. You have a pores. These pores inside, they are getting opened into a cavity. And here you have another opening. Okay. And this opening is actually called as osculum. Osculum. So whatever waste material is there, no, that will come out through this opening called osculum. Okay. So water, food and everything enters through pores. It reaches to the cavity and, you know, inside a cavity, the digestion, absorption of nutrients, everything happens. Okay. Whatever activities that happens inside a body, here everything happens in this cavity only. Once the water has gone, once the food has gone, the food should undergo digestion, isn't it? It's all a chemical reaction. So all these activities will take place in this cavity only. And whatever waste material is there, no, that waste material will come out through another opening, big opening called osculum. Okay. Waste will again do not come out through pores, guys. Okay. Waste things will come out through another opening called osculum. Right? So food and water goes through pores and the waste material will come out through another opening called osculum. Clear? So these are the main points that you have to remember about the phylum Porifera. And you know, the outer surface is hard here. Outer surface is hard because of the deposition of certain chemicals, guys. So, outer body is very much hard if you touch because of the deposition of calcium and silicon material. Okay. And this particular surface is also called as skeleton in this case. This is only the skeleton. Okay. The outer surface of the body is very much hard. It's because of the deposition of certain chemicals of calcium and silicon. And this outermost surface itself, we call it a skeleton. And you know, the skeleton, if you see the skeleton, right? The skeleton, see, this is the outer surface layer, I consider. Skeleton has certain cells. And they are also, you know, supported by certain structures called spicules. See, I will show the visual now. Once you see the visual, you will become perfect with the structure and various things that are happening in this particular organism. Okay. Say, and the best example I can give for Porifera is Cycon. Okay. Cycon. Spongilla. Try to remember the examples also. At least two examples. Cycon and Spongilla. So now let us see a beautiful visual on the sponges
of porifera. Yeah, see, this is a sponge. It is not moving. It is attached to a solid support always. Sponges do not move. See the surface, you have a small holes, isn't it? Say you can see, this is a pink color surface. You have small holes and inside there is a cavity. These holes will open up into a cavity. Okay, what is that cavity called? Spongocoel. I'll show that also. See, observe here. See, these are the holes inside. This is the inner part. If I cut open inside, this empty area is a cavity. Okay, and you know, this cavity lining is very thick, guys. It is actually made up of endoskeleton. You know, this is called endoskeleton, right? These are certain cells actually. And you know, this endoskeleton is a deposition of calcium and other minerals also. And anyway, this is not required for your level. Just try to remember, just inside the cavity, you know, the lining is very much thick. And this is called endoskeleton. And you can see, this is a spongocoel, isn't it? See, the empty cavity is called spongocoel. And you see how water is moving, guys. See, look at, the water is entering into a pore. It is moving into spongocoel. And from osculum, there is another opening. You can see here, this is an opening, right? So through this opening, the water comes outside. Clear? See, water is going through the pore. It is going to the spongocoel. And from the spongocoel, you know, whatever waste is there, that will come out through another opening called osculum. Okay? So this is what we call water canal system, isn't it? So you can observe nicely how water is going. And you look at here, whatever water is going, no, it is absorbed by these cells. These are some special cells. Okay, it is absorbed by these cells, guys. Whatever food, mineral, water goes into spongocoel, no, the water is absorbed by these cells inside the spongocoel. Right, you can observe that also. See, it is absorbed, waste is going outside. Okay, so water goes, absorption, waste coming outside. And this is how the sponges look like inside the ocean. Right, you see how hard outer surface is, very hard, and they are not moving also. Right, so that's all about sponges. Very simple organisms. Right, and try to remember about water canal system, one thing. And all over the body there are pores, so pores will open up into spongocoel. Spongocoel is a cavity, so through the pores water enters, and from another opening called osculum water comes outside. Right, so this much is the main points that you have to remember about spongocoel and sponges. And after this visual, let us discuss about the phylum Coelenterata.
Now, coming to the phylum Coelenterata, this phylum is also called as Cnidaria. C silent here. So, Cnidaria. Yeah, Cnidarians, or the organisms are called Coelenterates. Let us discuss the main features or characteristics of Coelenterata. And you know what? The meaning of the word seal, C-O-E-L, seal means cavity. And this cavity is like intestine. Is like intestine. You know, intestine is also called as enteron. Enteron, right? So, you have a cavity. Cavity means seal. Seal in the sense what, guys? Cavity. Enteron. Enteron in the sense what? Intestine. Clear? So you have a cavity which exactly looks like an intestine. I mean to say, it plays a role of intestine. What is the role of intestine in a body? Even we humans have an intestine, right? Below the stomach. What happens there? Digestion of food occurs. Okay, whatever food we eat, no, that food will break down into smaller and smaller pieces, and all nutrients gets absorbed in the intestine. So that is the main duty of intestine. So whatever intestine work is there, that is done by a cavity. You have a cavity. You don't have any intestine in an organism, but you have a cavity. So all physiological work, whatever digestion, absorption of nutrient, whatever has to happen in a body, everything happens in a cavity. Like we had though, in a porifera, we had a cavity called spongocele. So here also we will have a cavity called coelom. Okay, coelom, it is called as coelom or just seal. So, you know, let me draw organism of coelenteron. I'll take an example of hydra. So here the best example for coelenterata is hydra. You know how hydra looks like? So this is the body. Inside you have fully cavity. And you know, you have hair-like structures. Something like this. You know, this is a mouth. This is actually a mouth. Right? So this is a cavity, body cavity. And these hair-like structures are called tentacles. What do you call them as? Tentacles. Okay? So, and this is a mouth. This is a mouth. Mouth, whatever it has to eat, it will take from a mouth, it goes to a cavity. All breaking of food, digestion, absorption, everything happens inside this cavity only. Clear? And now, what is the use of this tentacles? Tentacles. Okay? T-E-N-T-A-C-L-E-S. Tentacles. So, these tentacles help in grabbing the food. Help in grabbing the food. Okay? And it also helps in movement. Movement. If an organism want to move, you know, these tentacles only will help in the movement, and they also help in grabbing the food. So once the tentacles grab the food goes through the mouth, and from the mouth it goes to a cavity. And cavity here is also called as seal, okay, or coelom. Clear? So this is how a body is framed in case of coelenterons. Okay, the best example is hydra. And you know, all are aquatic animals. Aquatic animals. They are present in sea. Okay? And you know what? Outermost surface is quite hard in some of the coelenterons. Have you observed corals? Another example for coelenterons is corals. Okay? So, corals are actually colored. If you go deep into an ocean, or you can observe it in movies also, right? Say when they swim deep into an ocean, you will observe a colored structures. So all are actually a living organisms, guys. And all of them belong to what phylum? All of them belong to a phylum, Coelenterata. Okay, so all corals, colorful corals, are also example for Coelenterata phylum. Clear? And you know, the outer surface is hard, okay, and this is actually called as exoskeleton. Outermost surface, you can observe it in a corals. So you will find something like this. You will find structures like this, colorful structures. You know, this outermost structure is very hard. Outermost body surface is very hard, and that surface is also called as exoskeleton. Clear? Fine. And now, you know, they are diploblastic. What do you mean by the word diploblastic? Diploblastic in the sense having two germ layers. What do you mean by germ layers? You know, guys, during reproduction, okay, so imagine you have a male and you have a female. When male produces some specialized sex cells called male gamete, right? Female produces female gamete. This is, I'm talking about reproduction. Like all organisms will reproduce, right? If they reproduce sexually, you know, male gamete will come from a male, female produces female gamete, both of them will combine. So a single cell structure is formed, that is zygote. Okay, so zygote again divides further and it becomes embryo. It becomes embryo. So embryo is multicellular. So many cells would be there in embryo. Okay, and these embryo divides into three layers of cells, guys. Okay, I will write here embryo. Okay, this is common in all organisms. Whichever organisms reproduce sexually, like in whichever organisms you see a concept that male gamete fuses with the female gamete to form a zygote and later zygote divides into embryo. So wherever, whichever organism you observe this concept, there what happens is our embryo divides into three layers of cells. Okay, three layers of cells, and these three layers of cells are called germ layers. We call them as germ layers, right? And what are these three layers? We call them as ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. Okay, these are the three germ layers, guys. Endoderm. So what are the three germ layers? Ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. So from where you get these layers of cells? Ectoderm is one layer of cells. Mesoderm is another layer of cell. Endoderm is the third layer of cell. Okay, where do you get these layers of cell? From embryo. Embryo only differentiates, divides into three layers. Okay, and what happens here is the ectoderm further makes, you know, this ectoderm, this layer of cells itself makes the skeleton of a body. Skeleton of a body. Okay, and the mesoderm is responsible in making, you know, this makes the organs. So various organs generates in an embryo, like further in a baby, right? So this is because of mesoderm cells. So the mesoderm cells later in the future is going to become various organs, okay? And endoderm makes the lining of organs. Okay, so each and every organ has a lining inside, right? Say for example, if you have a heart, you know, inside a heart, there is a layer, guys. There is a layer, thin protective layer. And this is what we call lining of the heart. Lining of the heart. Okay, so once the organ is formed, inside a lining has to be formed. So who will, which layer of cells will make the lining of organs and lining of body parts? That is endoderm layer. Clear? So this is the basic idea about the reproduction, like what happens for the embryo. Say out of the reproduction we got an embryo. Now embryo has to become a baby, isn't it? So before it becomes the entire baby, you know, that embryo initially differentiates, divides into three layers of cells, guys. First layer of cell is called ectoderm, second layer of cells mesoderm, third layer of cell endoderm. So ectoderm is the germ layer responsible in making skeleton of a body. Mesoderm is responsible in making organs. Endoderm layer of cell is responsible for making lining of the organs. Okay, so these layers of cells are the basic layers from which tissues are forming, later organs will form, organ systems are forming. Clear? And now in these organisms, the embryo divides into only two germ layers. Okay, so you don't observe the formation of three germ layers. Only two germ layers are formed. That is the reason we call it as diploblastic. Di in the sense what? Two. Okay. So embryo divides into two germ layers. Embryo has only two germ layers, guys. Okay. It has only ectoderm and endoderm. There is no mesoderm. Okay. So one layer of cells will form the outer body or outer skeleton. Another layer of cells will form the lining of a body. Okay, that's it. So that is the reason we call these organisms are diploblastic, having two germ layers. Okay, having two germ layer. One germ layer. Okay, that means you have ectoderm. One germ layer, that is ectoderm, makes the skeleton of a body. Skeleton of a body. What do you mean by skeleton here? Outer surface. Outer surface. Okay. See, we have already discussed outer surface is hard, that is called exoskeleton. So, which germ layer is responsible in forming outer surface, hard surface, that is ectoderm, germ layer number one, that is ectoderm. Okay. And among the two germ layers, another layer, that is the second germ layer. Second germ layer makes the lining of inside body. Lining of inside body. Okay. Lining of body cells, which is present inside, not outside. Clear? So which is this germ layer? Which layer actually makes the lining, guys? Endoderm. So in case of sealant rata, you have only two germ layers. One is ectoderm and another one is endoderm. You don't have mesoderm. That's the reason you don't have any organs in case of sealant rates. Okay, there is no heart, there is no liver, nothing. Organs are not there, only tissues would be there. Okay, so these sealant rates have tissue level organization. Okay, so tissues would be there, but there are no organs. In case of porifera, tissues are also not there. The entire body is made up of simple cells only. That is cell level organization we call. But this is tissue level organization you will observe in sealant rata. Little more advanced than porifera. Okay. Much more advanced than porifera. So these are the points that you have to remember about sealant rata. Okay. So the first one is they are aquatic animals. The outer surface is hard, that is exoskeleton. And you know the body has a cavity. Cavity is surrounded by tentacles, hair-like structure. So whatever food the organism takes, it goes to a cavity. Inside a cavity only digestion, absorption, everything happens. Okay. And the sealant traits are diploblastic. That means they have only two germ layers. So I gave you entire idea about what are germ layers and how the germ layers come. Isn't it? So there are three germ layers. First one, second one, third one. In all the organisms, three germ layers would be there. But in case of sealant rata, only two germ layers are there. Right? Okay. So now let us have a look at the beautiful visual on sealant rata. Okay. And before going to the visual, one more point that you have to remember, that is they can be colonial or solitary. So what do you mean by colonial? Colonial in the sense staying in groups. The organism can stay in a group or the organism can stay single. Okay. The sealant rate organisms can stay single. Here the example is Hydra. Or sealant rate organisms can stay in colonies, that is in groups. Right. So that's the reason I wrote they can be colonial or solitary. So these words meanings are very important, guys. You must understand the meaning of the word diploblastic. You must understand the meaning of the word colonial, solitary. Colonial in the sense staying in groups. Solitary in the sense staying single. The organism can stay in groups or the organism can stay single. So now let us have a look at the Coelenterata.
Let us see the visual on Coelenterata. Two varieties, jellyfish and polyps, come under Coelenterata. See, this is the jellyfish. You can see this is the mouth, tentacles, you know, this is coelom cavity, right? Inside you have a cavity, mouth, and these hair-like structures are called tentacles. See, tentacles help the body to move and also to capture the food. See how the fish is going inside the cavity, and inside the cavity all digestion and all will happen. Every life process occurs in a cavity only. See, and another variety of Coelenterata is polyps. These are polyps. Okay, see, very different structures, colorful structures you will find in the ocean. Different varieties of polyps are available, guys. And even these guys also capture their food itself, right? See how the fish has been captured by the polyp, isn't it? Say, these are the different varieties of Coelenterata. Say, all these are Coelenterata only. And even corals can come under Coelenterata variety itself, right? So this is all about the phylum Coelenterata. So with this, I complete the phylum Porifera as well as Coelenterata. In my next class, let us try to meet with another phylum, that is Platyhelminthes. Clear? Till then, keep revising the concept. See you in the next class.